Hello, this is Grandmaster Jerry Fassi Fontenot with another episode of Anime Power Talk. This time we're going all the way to Long Island in the Boogie Down Bronx. That's right. Now, throughout the years, people have been able to go and get involved in martial arts, sometimes in Kung Fu or Karate or what have you. And then sometimes they crossed over to other forms of pugilism, which could include boxing or kickboxing or MMA or what have you. This gentleman has an opportunity not only as a competitor, but also as a, well, not just competitor, multiple world champion, but more importantly, he has a team of people and has had them for many, many years, whether it's his instructor and or his students, his brother, crossed over to become a promoter. I mean, when it's all said and done, one of the renaissance men in martial arts, even though kickboxing became minuscule compared to it was in the past, he has never skipped a beat and been involved in the entire thing. And I'm happy to say that he may not understand it, maybe realize, but even my man, Master Joe Corley, actually had PK fights in Canada just a few weeks ago, 2 weeks ago, and they were recorded. So kickboxing, he held on to it and is on his way back. Anyway, without further ado, we got, I'm not sure if it's Sensei or Sifu, Tommy B. Batone. Are you there, sir?
Yes, sir. Jerry Fontenot, thank you very much for having me on the show. I really appreciate it.
Oh, man, it's my pleasure. My pleasure. And it's interesting because I can say this, that my wife, Michelle, you know, haunting us today, Conheim back in the day, she's the reason why I even got a chance to see some of the kickboxing, thinking that it was all done years ago. And you know, because I come from, obviously, I'm a little older, so I'm coming from the PK days. And I didn't realize the USKBA, rest in peace to Paul Rosner, was even around and all the stuff that happened. But let's talk about you, because it's not about me. In the beginning, what was your inspiration, desperation, or your motivation when it comes to the martial arts?
Well, I got kind of a different story than a lot of guys. You know, I still grew up kind of tough, you know, fighting in the streets all the time. And I kind of got lucky. You know, I was watching PK and some of the other stuff that Lou Negley was doing on TV. And yeah, it piqued my interest a little bit, so I watched some of the fights, like Mike Sexton. I watched fight on TV. I watched a couple of people fighting. And, you know, one day I was just happening to be getting gas by my house, and I saw my Sifu Moses Orocho, you know, doing some sparring. They had guys outside doing sparring. It was summertime. And, you know, I went in, checked it out, and saw everybody sparring. I saw him sparring. They had a team from South America there. They were training to go to the World Championships. I believe it was in Beijing at that time for San Xiao. And it piqued my interest. I told him I wanted to fight, and the rest is history.
Wow. That's interesting. You just mentioned San Xiao, and obviously kickboxing or Muay Thai or continuous contact, whatever you want to call it, has been around for a long, long time. What was interesting about San Xiao, well, I loved is seeing those scissor takedowns, and I believe Chung Lee was the champion, or Kung Lee.
I was doing it before he was, and we almost met a couple of times in the World Championships because he was a little heavier than me. I fought at 165, and he fought at 175. And my last championship that I won in San Xiao in a tournament was in Florida. I think it was called the USA WKF, and that was his first national championship that he won.
Wow. Now, what year are we talking about here, just to get a timeline?
That was 1994. It was in Orlando, Florida. And I came back, and I fought on the first card at San Xiao Show. I was the main event against a San Xiao champion from Boston, Josh Bartholomew. And it was promoted by guys you probably know as David Ross, Kung Fu guys, Steven Ventura. They had New York Kung Fu and Karate, and you know, it was in Manhattan, and they both still have schools. But they promoted the first San Xiao card, where it was, you know, single fights instead of a tournament, and that was held in New York City.
Wow. So interesting. Now, how about as a youngster, were you ever one of those karate or kung fu fans? It doesn't seem like it, but just curious.
Not really.
Involved in other sports?
I'll be honest with you, the only sport I ever partook in when I was growing up was wrestling, because it was the most similar to fighting. And I kind of missed my boat on that, because I was actually undefeated for like 5 years, but I kept getting thrown out of school for fighting, believe it or not. And,
well, that could be the combination of being a Puerto Rican and Italian. I can only say that because that's the same blood that I have. just so you
Yeah.
know. Or maybe being born in the Bronx, you know, that can also create some of that energy and testosterone that people just can't handle, even us we can't, until we find out when we get older what to do with it.
I was born on 233rd Street at Misericordia Hospital. I think it's called something else now. It's still a Catholic hospital, I believe. And I came out to Long Island when I was 8. And, you know, I had my share of fights, kind of fought all the time since I was a little kid. And if I didn't find martial arts when I did, I would be probably in prison by now.
Yeah, well, that's one of the things. When we say karate saved our life, doesn't mean that we got into an altercation that was able to protect us. It was that we had, some of us had that energy that if it wasn't focused on something positive, we would have been dead or in jail like many of our friends.
Absolutely. That's why, you know, people wonder why I charge much less than everybody else at my school. To me, it's not about making money. I actually, you know, I have a full-time job, so after I retired from fighting, I went back to work. And, you know, to me, it's about helping the kids in the neighborhood where I grew up. So I charge very, very little compared to probably about a third of what the average school charges. And I just want to be able to teach the kids where I grew up.
Well, as long as you're being fulfilled, then that's really what it comes down to. But let me talk a little specific over here, because what I did notice when I, my wife Michelle and I got together back in 1998 was that she was a promoter, and there was an army of guys, it doesn't matter if it was professionals or amateurs, young and or old, that were just coming from the school. And I believe your brother, who looks like a real good fighter himself, not sure if he is, but he looked like a killer. You know, you guys were not only promoting, but competing and having the school that was doing phenomenal. Let's talk about some of that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, you guys were promoting amateurs in New Jersey, and I would bring my, we always, you know, try to work with the best people that are doing the right thing for the sport, you know, so we used to bring competitors to your events all the time. And, you know, I've always tried to find, you know, the gritty kids and give them a positive place to go. Since I've been open 19 years ago, we opened a school in 1996. I think we've trained 13 world champions, you know, professional and amateur. So, you know, it's a combination, I guess, of the kids we find and the experience that we have. And, you know, we try to take our experience and do the best we can to give them the, you know, the best experience they can as a martial artist.
Well, again, you know, it's not easy to be, because I think there's people who are champions and there's people who are trainers. It's a unique situation when you're leading by example, as I would call it. I believe, and just to get a little specific and give the shout outs where they're due. Oh, by the way, just so you know, even though I think you do know, my wife Michelle was the promoter, and all I was trying to do whatever she wanted me to do. But it was, you know, I don't care, whatever she wanted me to do, because it was such an interesting thing to see that little lady, even though she was my wife eventually, just freaking be all over the place in something that I thought was completely gone. And it really wasn't. I know it wasn't, but since I'm used to being in Madison Square Garden and in the big arenas and seeing it on ESPN TV, it had went from what would have been the heyday to an underground almost, you know? Even though it was on MSG Network, and your guys were passionate about it. But let's give some shout out to some of your students who were champions.
Well, I mean, the best fighters that I've trained that's still with me is Keith Youngs. He became a professional world champion at 126 pounds, and he became a champion at 19 years old. And he became a world champion professional. He came from Sifu Moses Sirocha also. He was one of his students. And he came with me, and we trained, you know, I trained him, took over his training 100% when he was like 14 years old, and by the time he was 19, he was a professional world champion. Besides him, you know, Adam Zacker, which was one of my best students ever, he was an amateur world champion. He did pro boxing, he did MMA, he's done everything. So some of these students that we've had over the years, they've all become, you know, really what our goal was. If we set up the goal, they all met it, you know. They've all become great men, too. You know, they all become, good family men. Most of them, are, for some reason, end up in law enforcement now. Actually, both of those individuals are correction officers as well. And, you know, I do that too now. So they both have become really good men. And they have, you know, Keith Youngs has a family, and it's great to see the development that these, you know, fine young students have turned out to be great young men.
Well, this is interesting because you said it, I concurred it, and now the history still proves it to be right. Any way you put it, guys, the whether it's a jail is going to always be something around when people get out of line. And because of martial arts, whether it's kickboxing, San Chao, and when I say martial arts, it's the umbrella of all of them, because of that, they get a chance to be involved in jail, but from the good side as opposed to the bad side.
Absolutely. Hey, people said I would end up in jail one day, and they were right. Just I'm on the right side of the bars. But no, these kids are good kids. You know, they've never had any troubles, and they grew up right. And you know, they're doing the right thing in the community, and they all are still 100% involved in my school. Many of my students over the years, you know, they still help out. I mean, I have so many. We're still involved in promotions as well. Right now we're doing a fundraiser for a fellow officer where his family, his wife is very sick. So we're doing 100% fundraiser for her, and it's officer against officer. It's going to be kickboxing and mixed martial arts and stuff. And, you know, we're going to give 100% of the door to the family, which we've done, you know, many events like that with my brother in the past, but this is a department thing, and it's, you know, it's really good to do something positive for somebody you know, and it gives officers an opportunity to do something that they maybe never wanted to try before, but now they're trying for the first time.
Well, it sounds like you're spreading love, and it continues to do it, you know, and that's the thing that this has all been about. You know, throughout the years, whether it's kicking and punching, and, you know, I don't care what style anyone has ever done. I particularly love all forms of martial arts, and the ring sports themselves, to me, man, I respect anyone at any level who puts the stuff on the line in any ring. That goes out to all those people.
I've always believed the same thing. You know, when I was coming up, I used to watch you point fight. You know, I went to point fight and continuous kickboxing, boxing. I've basically been a piece of every part of martial arts since I've been in it, you know. And, you know, I remember watching you with those ABCs at the end, you know, when you're fighting, all that crazy stuff, you know.
I didn't know that.
Martial arts. You could ask Moses. You know, I used to go. I was the guy getting disqualified all the time in the tournaments. But hey, I tried. And you know, but I watched you. You know, pretty much right before you retired, I was watching you out there. You know, and I watched everybody from point fighting, continuous. You know, every style. I trained with wrestlers, grapplers. Trained with Gene Fabricant for Russian Sambo. Everything. You know, we've basically always believed that fighting is punching, kicking, and wrestling, and I always try to look to the best people at each individual style and see what I can pick up on and, you know, add it to what we do. You know, I know you believe the same thing, that, you know, you never stop learning. You know, you can always learn something new, and you can always tweak something and get better at it.
Yeah, well, I don't believe I know nothing. I don't know anything. I'm going to be 50 years old, and I'm looking forward to getting better, because there's no way in life that I believe that I'm anywhere near of what it is with some people in certain respects of freaking striking and what have you. And I'm excited because I know that today we get more options to see and respect things when marketing has made things limited from throughout the years. We get a chance to see the full gamut of martial arts, and I'm probably one of the top two fans of any form of martial arts. That's why when I'm the place you see me, I'm electrified. No, it's not on drugs. I get excited about this freaking thing. Hey, let's talk about your career, because I know you've won a bunch of titles and mentioned maybe some of your hardest fights and your greatest victories.
I'd say some of my hardest fights come in, you know, they're at different stages. They're all hard, you know. Some of my hardest fights in the early pro days were against Mike Sandman Sexton. And, you know, we had some controversial decisions, but, you know, we had some great fights. And he was around before me. You know, he was basically the king of the middleweights before I came up. And he was knocking everybody out. And I got – we had two title fights, seven-round fights. And he was an amazing fighter. And I actually wanted to defend my title against him and my world championship against him later on. And he fought an elimination fight against John Kenny, which is round way before both of us. And John Kenny knocked him out. So John Kenny got to fight me again. I already beat John Kenny once before that. And I got to defend my world title against John Kenny after he knocked Mike Sexton out. So those two guys were four of my hardest fights, without a doubt. I've also... And John Kenny is so tough. He made a comeback again after that, and he worked his way up, and he fought Tony TNT Ventura, which that was an elimination to fight me again for my world championship, and that's the guy I took my title from. Tony Ventura shocked the world and knocked John Kenny out in the first round in Atlantic City. So
wow.
John Kenny knocked Mike Sexton out. Tony Ventura knocked John Kenny out the first round. And I think that's kind of what happens, you know, when you want a world championship so bad, it's going to bring out the best in people, you know. And I believe those two fights, those two elimination fights to fight me for my title were two of the best kickboxing fights I've ever seen. And
you know that, and that's the part right there. Now, let me do that. As you're speaking, sir, my hairs are standing up. And I'll tell you why. Because I put myself in that mindset. And this is what I told people throughout the years, and it's the absolute truth. And maybe you can attest to it or not. I would watch these guys fight against each other. And I would be like, oh, my God. It was like watching Godzilla versus King Kong. And I was scared in terms of what I was so scared that I trained so hard that I would beat them because of the fear. I didn't want them to beat me, but I respected them so much as a spectator that they were doing incredible, and I cheered as much, if not louder, than everybody else. Did that happen to you?
Absolutely. I mean, I'm the biggest fan of martial arts you'll ever meet, and I respect every aspect of the game, and boxing as well. I've watched one of the best fights I ever fought. I think you may have worked, I mean, I ever watched. Kickboxing, I think you may have worked the corner for Henry the Hitman Nieves when he fought Luis Ruiz in the Bronx.
Oh, my gosh.
That was one of the sickest kickboxing fights I've ever seen.
You know what was so interesting about that? This is, and I don't know if you know this, but I know Luis Bad Boy Ruiz since he had an afro in the karate days. I talked with Ron Henderson, who was the first person who was able to bridge the gap, considered a blitz. And in 1988, he made some T-shirts for me. So I was just a major fan because he was rated in Karate Illustrated back in the late 70s as a teenager. So Henry Nieves was the gentleman who was doing point karate because we were going from point karate to kickboxing, what would have been called full contact, until everything changed. That was the plan. I wanted to be the new Super Phil Wallace. But what messed me up personally was that I had friends of mine, Tony Arnold, Yo Judah, Michael Husbands, and those guys that fought for titles, right? Just some of them had titles. I watched them on television. And we were making more money than the kickboxers, and they were champions. I was like, what? I need money every weekend. So that's why I fought point karate, because I had made more money there, and I was a father at age 17, and I didn't have a job. So my vocation was go to the weekends, make some money.
Hey, listen, you know as well as I do, at the time when I came up, kickboxing was at a real low, you know. And
the lowest.
You mentioned some of those guys. Most of those guys have been to my school and helped me train for my title fights. You know, Tony Arnold has been to my school, Michael Husbands, another great, Devon Cormack. You know, like all of these guys, we all help each other, you know. There wasn't no money. We didn't do it for the money. You know, we did it because we loved it.
And that's my point. See, Michael Husbands we did his power talk on Sunday. And Michael Husbands, obviously, you know, and I have to tell you how humble this guy is, right? And Devon Cormack and all these guys all came from the same operation in terms of Fatal. Rest in peace to William Oliver and Tadashi Nakamura, who is alive. But the point is that What I loved about kickboxing as known today, back in the day, full contact, was that it didn't matter what style you was, you were able to test your skills inside of a ring, regardless of background, and use what worked. When I watched you fight, it was interesting. And I'll tell you why in a second. But let's get it back to the Hitman against Bad Boy. To me, Bad Boy was one generation slightly before me. So in karate, I was, what he was ending the point karate, I was in the middle of my point karate. And Henry Nieves, Hitman, was directly behind me. He was a great point fighter also that crossed over to the kickboxing, except that, again, in my situation, I needed money. So I can make $1,000 a week, and a lot of times back in the days, just by fighting the point tournament and do it just about 2-3 times a month, you know, which was cool. When to be a kickboxer, you couldn't get that.
You know, I used to watch my Sifu Moses do the same thing. You know, he used to go and he went point, continuous, and forms all in the same day, and weapons.
It didn't matter. And that's exactly why we, you know, he is and you are, just so you know, everyone who I have do what's considered a power talk is people that I thought about. If I went to war and I had an opportunity to have an army of only 300 people, just like the movie, who would I have? I would have to have people for different reasons. And you, Mr. Batone, are one of my 300 people I would love to have on my army if I fought any army in the world. That's what this is about. And so is this talk about.
I mean, I'll tell you, you might not believe it because most time kickboxers don't appreciate point fighting, but I give credit to you. I watched you fight when I was coming up, and you did things that I could never do in the point, you know, point karate. So I give credit to where credit's due. I teach kicks. I wish I could show you if we had a video here that I actually teach kicks that I give credit to you, Muay Thai, and traditional karate, where I kind of mold them all together.
Well, let me tell you something, what I mean about that. When I saw you fight, I said, wait a second. This guy here is a hybrid fighter. And what I mean by that is, you was killing them with your kicks and the angles of it. Yes, you can still punch with them, but what made you different to me and a lot of your students, but you in particular, I'd say, wait a second. It's almost like when you look at Don Wilson fight, and you can tell Don Wilson did point karate because he used to hit people with a sidekick to the face. And this is the point. Every form of striking is point karate in the sense that you want to hit them without them hitting me. But if you just continue the flow, then they call that continuous contact. If you continue the flow and change the rules, they may call that, you know, kickboxing or MMA. But it still comes down to the offense and defense. I don't think, maybe I'm wrong, that when I saw you fight, you wasn't in range to get hit that often, and you was killing these people with kicks. Even though John Keeney, and I know he's taller than you, and I know he threw that front kick, but because he threw the front kick, his hips were square, and you was throwing side kicks and roundhouse kicks, and you was able to beat him being shorter, but you still was throwing longer techniques. Am I wrong?
Absolutely. I mean, you're right. That's what, I mean, as you know, my teacher was a great kicker. You know, and I give him credit for that. And I also give you credit with the way you used to sneak, you know, you call it the sniper technique. But
yes.
The way I used to throw my rear full contact, well, I still throw it and teach it every day. My full contact roundhouse kick, we call it, is like, you know, the rear leg roundhouse. I kind of steal a little bit from you, the way you used to do that flip kick coming over the shoulder. From the lead leg, I do that from my rear leg, you know.
They can't see it.
Sneak it up on you and come over the top and then finish it off like a tie kick. You know, and I give credit where credit's due, man. I watch everybody. I study everybody in every style. And I think today there's not enough people doing that. They're not giving credit to the people who came before them or the people that are doing different styles. There's something to learn from everybody. And you know,
all right, let me just tell you this. And you was one of the people that literally made me step up to the next level when you asked me a few days ago, hey, is there a link for C4 Rocho's power talk? And the idea is this, and I think you're going to get the idea because you made me do it. And I said, yeah, give me a little while and I'll do it. By the way, I am the web designer / app maker and everything else, just so you know, because I know it's going to be done if I do it, but I also have a team. But the point is that the purpose of the Dojam is to create a connection, an interconnection between all of us. There'll be people from all over the world, whether it's Keith Vitale, who I just interviewed, you know, one of the best point fighters, movie guys in a long time, and guys like Fearless Vasquez, you know, all across the board, people that, I respect for different reasons that I'll have on my team in terms of my mind. So when people go to the dojo, they're going to get the story from a variety of people. Now, once they go to the person's particular page, that page is going to have content, whether it's links back to their website or maybe even clips and pictures and videos that they choose to put on their site. I'll put the content in for them. So when you mentioned about techniques, let's say you had some videos of how to teach this or how to teach that. We could put that onto your site. Let's say you were selling those things. We could put the link to your site and you could sell it over there. It's my way to say thank you.
Absolutely. I think it's great because you know, like I've been, obviously, you ever got a chance to look at my website, ringoffirekickboxing.com, but
I was there today.
We've been doing that, you know, not as in detail with you, like every little interview, but as you see, that it's never been about me. You know,
it's
about martial arts, boxing, MMA, kickboxing, anything that really interests me, because I know I'm a big fan of martial arts. So if I really like something, I'm going to put it out there to help that person promote it, because we all need to help each other, you know, and it's good to get, if you have something that has good exposure, to help the people that could use the exposure, you know.
Well, that's absolutely true. And, you know, and it's funny because throughout the years, you know, there was a time where I had multiple schools and you know, they had my brand on it. But that's really what it was. I always told people, I'm not Fontenelle's Karate. I'm not the Totally Awesome team. I'm an individual that happens to be involved in that whole entire operation. But I strongly know and believe that the martial arts community is a family as dysfunctional as any good family, you know, with multiple aspects of it. You know, there's no way in life that those of you guys who are listening to Mr. Baton right now, he seems really cool and laid back, and he is. But if it's time to go to war, trust me, you're going to hear him and everybody else voice their opinion, because that's what it's about. It's about that passion and that desire, and our opportunity to be able to exercise that right is what martial arts has been able to let us do. Otherwise, if we did that in other realms, then yes, you will be on the other side of those bars. Hey, let me mention a few names. I want you just to talk a bit, you know, tell me what you think. Paul Vizio.
Paul Vizio was probably the second best lightweight there ever was in kickboxing. He was a great, great fighter, you know, but he came around a little before my guy Keith Youngs, but that's the fight we always wanted, and he kind of retired before we got the chance to prove that.
Well, if I'm going to be 50, the question would be, we don't even know how old Mr. Vizio is.
Oh, my God. He was fighting. I think he was 50 when I started.
But this is my point. In the meantime, he never skipped the beat, right? This is a gentleman who literally hit somebody with a 360 spinning hook kick to the head in the last round just to prove a point.
He was an amazing fighter. I mean, he can kick, he can punch, he had good movement, he just had great control of the ring. He was an amazing guy. And I'm not knocking him by saying I wanted my guy to fight.
No, I understand. It's a matter of opinion. Come on, buddy. I get you.
Him to fight him to, you know, because you always want to fight the best, you know, and that would have been. That would have been the fight for him, you know. So, you know, we believe me, I have nothing but tremendous respect for him. He was an unbelievable fighter.
But again, just being honest, right, I'm not trying to be cute here. Do you know how old he is? Because we don't know. I'll tell you why. He was fighting Fu Jiao Pai in the 70s.
I know.
Okay?
I have no idea.
Oh, no, he fought. And now in the early 80s, he was PKA world champion.
I know.
So let's think about this right now. So if you take
when I first started, that I'd look in the programs and they said they were 30 or 35, and then 10 years later I see them fight again. I see the program that says they're 30 or 35.
But that's what I'm saying. We don't even know if he's 100 years old. You know, he's been a long time.
No, but you know what? He's one of those guys that absolutely deserves tremendous credit. I mean, he was an all around fighter. He was incredibly skilled. So I give him a lot of credit.
All right, let me mention some guys that maybe might have come before you started, but maybe you had a chance to see some of their stuff. And one of them is a very, very good friend of mine who was an excellent point fighter. And he's also from Long Island, comes from a traditional style of Shotokan, was instructor with Tokyo, and his name is Eric Panzer.
Oh, Dark fans, like as I told you, I started basically in martial arts around 1990, so that was kind of